Having grown up in a distinguished family, his great-grandfather a medicine man and tribal leader, his grandfather a missionary priest, his aunt a noted anthropologist, and his father the first American Indian named to a national post in the Episcopal Church, Vine Deloria knows what it means to influence those around him and to put words to the struggle of the American Indian. Although not promoting himself as a leader, he has become one of the leading figures in the presentation and analysis of contemporary Indian affairs, and is truly the voice of his generation. His work with the United Scholarship Fund has enabled many Indian students to attend college. While executive director of the National Congress of American Indians, he influenced policy decisions and worked for changes long overdue. It has been said the experience of working at the NCAI was the incubator for his first book, Custer Died for Your Sins. Using humor and wit, he has been able to draw attention to issues facing the American Indian people, both within and outside their tribal boundaries. His work has many recurring themes, including Indian self-determination, assisting tribes with knowledge of their legal rights, treaties, religion, and his concern for our national environment. The Custer book was followed by We Talk, You Listen, God is Red, Behind the Trail of Broken Treaties, and many others. Mr. Deloria has been the recipient of many awards, including the Annisfield Wolf Award for Custer Died for Your Sins, Lifetime Achievement Awards for both the Native Writers of America and Mountains and Plains Booksellers Association, the Spirit of Excellence Award from the American Bar Association, and the Wallace Stegner Award from the Center for the American West. Although retired from the University of Colorado, he continues to write and to inspire those around him. My father, Clifton Hill, who fought for treaties rights as well as the right to vote in our own nation, along with his sister, Ella Jean Chowdhury, found his words to be a great inspiration. It is my honor and pleasure to present the 2003 Festival of Words Author Award to Vine Deloria, Jr.
Nice, isn't it? I have a hell of a time getting it through security.
Want to stay? I tell him, I just whispered to him, this is nice, but I'll have a hell of a time getting it by security. Well, this morning has turned out to be kind of this is your life thing. I was sitting over there, and Don Reynolds, who lives here, and was a very close friend of mine in a little military school we both went to 55 years ago, showed up with a picture of me in a totally untypical pose, sleeping in a bed. So, Don, stand up. It was just great for you to come. Can you imagine remembering someone for 55 years? And then I turn around, and there is a gentleman here at the Tulsa Law School that I used to beat up rhetorically because he worked for the government, and and that's John Vance, former commissioner of the Indian Claims Commission. John, and then right here is Hazel Dean John, who was a student at Arizona when I was there. So I guess Muhammad Ali couldn't make it, and I will recover my... I was kind of expecting you to teach the audience some Indian Sign Language when you mentioned the sign language. But he didn't teach you any sign language, right? Well, I'll give you a quick lesson. First, I'll do the signs. You tell me what it is. And if you can't tell me what it is, then I'll go through it again and translate it for you. Are you ready? Okay, Jonna, what did I say?
Thank you.
What? Thank you. Great, yeah, hey! Well, I'll report to the other tribes that the people in Tulsa really know the sign language. That's the first time anybody's gotten that in the audience. I used to start my history classes by saying, well, what's the first thing you know? Does anybody know? You're not going to miss this. What's the first thing you know? Oh, Jed's a millionaire. Well, there are no Beverly Hillbilly watchers here, I guess. Anyway, I'm very happy to be here. It's been a wonderful experience. And when I was sitting there autographing, Norma Bluebird came up to me. And I haven't seen her for at least 55, 60 years. Our folks were an outstanding couple up there at the Pine Ridge Reservation. Where, Norma, are you still here? Yes, way in the back there. Wave to her. And I remember her dad, Philip, taking care of so many people in the blizzard of 49. And Philip and Lydia were really the focal point of the Allen community up there at Pine Ridge. I'm delighted to see her. I'm supposed to talk just a little while, right? And then I'd like to suggest, particularly to younger people in the audience, that this is a great time to be alive and to be into intellectual things and to be using libraries. The last book I did, Evolution, Creationism, and Other Modern Myths, I take some swipes at both evolutionists and creationists. And I want to tell you some of the things I didn't want to put in the book because I make it a practice to criticize one group and praise another. See? So when this group comes after me, the others say, no, no, he's a good guy. And I sit and watch the two of them fight. If I put the rest of this in. If those of you who read the book find that really high, geologists and astronomers are the great guys, and evolutionists are the bad guys. If I'd put some of this in, why, all of them would have gone after me. So, next trip, critique geology, I guess. Two years ago, ran into a young man named Ross Hamilton, who was kind of inspired by my little statement in Red Earth, White Lies, that in talking to traditional elders from different tribes, I was uncovering stories about giant people. And these were people from 7 to 12 feet tall. And when I discovered Ross, he had gathered about 50 newspaper items of stories of either scientific excavation or accidental discovery by farmers in western New York, western Pennsylvania, and the majority of Ohio, extending down through Tennessee and Kentucky into Alabama. And so we started emailing back and forth. And it got to be very exciting because we got some other people to help us. He now has over 500 different items. And we're starting to dig up very ancient Indian stories about who these people were and where they came from. Now, the Six Nations people have preserved a lot of stories of these extremely tall people for all these years. So you get a lot of stories from the Six Nations. Delaware has also had these stories, but the best story I've found came out of Oklahoma. And during the Writers Project in the 30s, they went down to Durant and they found this very old Choctaw man. And he told the story of how the giants came from Ohio, came down into Mississippi and badly abused the Choctaws. So they had to run into the mountains and live in caves, and they had a very difficult time. The giants were out all day long, and the giants would kill them if they saw them. So the Choctaws were the little people, and the giants were the big and evil people. And what happens, a young Choctaw man discovered the blowgun. And so then they mixed up poisons, put them on the ends of darts. And they go out at night, and they'd come up on these giant villages or camps. And using the blowgun, they would hit a number of giants every day. The giants, subject to the same things as we are, they were just like us, only taller. Giant population began to decline in a big hurry with all these poison darts going into people. Giants, being very big, apparently thought these were mosquitoes or something going after them, and it took them off the giants to understand. But the Choctaw story is that's how they drove the giants out of the Mississippi area. And so giants eventually withdrew up to Ohio. I held a conference last May, and we tried to get people from the elders from a number of tribes to talk about their giant stories. And many tribes still hold these so closely that when they got up to speak, they didn't want to talk about giants, which kind of flattened my conference a little bit. But you'd stand there and listen to an elder tell the story of his life, how he was a telephone repairman and he was in the Air Force and he did all this, you're waiting for the giants, not a word. He'd take a break, go outside for a cigarette, and he says, well, I didn't want to mention it, but actually last spring we found this 12-foot skeleton. I know he didn't know what to do, and I'd practically scream at him, go back in there and tell the people, particularly when my funders are there, you know. But now, as I say, we have over 500, items. We're able now to put them on maps and track out and find out even where the giant villages are. And we've enlisted two or three reasonably intelligent archaeologists, and you've got to look hard to find two or three of them. So we hope someday to be able to pinpoint a specific county or a specific area near a river or someplace where we can dig. A lot of it's been covered over by subsequent urban development. There once was a site near eastern Minot, North Dakota, that had over 40 acres of ruins and graves of these giant people. And we've identified three scholarly digs where they actually took these bones of these creatures. And it's just like the end of Raiders of the Lost Ark. They go into the Smithsonian, and they're buried there, and people claim not to have ever done that. So that last scene where the Ark of the Covenant's put in the storehouse, that's real. I mean, that's not made up. So we're hoping by subterfuge to be able to drag some of those things out. So I mentioned that briefly, but not... didn't want to pull it in full force because the conservatives in academia come rushing out and say, oh, no. My theory, though, is if you got 500 items saying that you've dug these things up, it can't be a fraud and it can't be mythology, that much is sufficient evidence to really go out and research. Now, we've done this without any funding. We've done it without any academic support. In fact, in defiance of some scholars and some departments. And I mention this for younger people because it's very easy to do. All of you are much better at the computer than any of us older people. So if it wasn't for email and that free soil solitaire game, I probably wouldn't even touch a computer. Now, that's one thing that I want to encourage you to do. Pick something that you believe in that is totally irrational in terms of the received wisdom of the day and follow it out and see what it looks like. Ross has no academic training. We now have a third member, Pat Mason, is a housewife in Mount Perry, Ohio. And she's proved to be an absolute genius in going out and figuring out how to dig things out. And she's kind of a transition figure in another field I'm doing, which I'll never live to see the end of it, but I want to lay the groundwork so I can hand it on to younger scholars who'd be interested. And then it's about 20 years ago I found a report. It's called the Doheny Expedition into the Grand Canyon, 1926. It was prior to Doheny getting involved in the Teapot Dome oil scandal. And Doheny had a lot of money and wanted to sponsor scientific things. He had hitchhiked around the West when he was a young man and was intrigued by the Grand Canyon. So most of the prominent scientists of the day signed on to this expedition. If you got an oil man paying the bill, you can do a whole lot of things, as you people in Tulsa know. So I'm sure all you're getting a free ride from all these oil companies on everything, eh? No? My, that's surprising. So they go down the Grand Canyon. They're looking around just to see what's there. They had gone down there on the rumors that there was an old castle there. And what they see on the canyon wall is a petroglyph, which means somebody came in with a hammer or a harder rock and just pecked away and drew the outlines of things. A petroglyph of a dinosaur and a human being trying to fight the dinosaur. Now, when this reported, of course, the scientific world lost their minds. You know, you can't say that. And they say, no, this is what we found. And they made drawings of it, and they finally did find the remnants of an old fort up on the rim of the Grand Canyon, not down below. So I used to mention that to anthropologists and archaeologists. I go, what about the Doheny expedition? No one could explain it, and no one wanted to believe in it. And they all would say, that old thing. I'd say, well, look, there are a lot of old things that are still true. We follow the Constitution of the United States, which is 200 years old. Some people in weird places in the United States actually follow the Bible, which must be about 4,000 years old. So the Doheny Report should fall somewhere in between the two. But their only response was, well, that was just old. So I used it, you know, just to annoy people. And once or twice in my lifetime, I've done that. You're not going to believe that. But, then I ran into, I'd known Donna House, Navajo lady, for a long time, but I didn't realize the extent of her studies. She is, I think, the world's leading expert on desert plants, and high plateau plants, lives in San Juan Pueblo, and is hardly ever home because she's consulting all over the world for arid land vegetation, all kinds of things. Well, there she is collecting petroglyphs of dinosaurs. So I got very interested, and we met in Taos last summer, and she had a couple of weeks off. She went into the Taos museums and went through something like 16,000 negatives and slides and collected all kinds of petroglyphs that look like dinosaurs or look like big animals. And as she showed me some of these, I began to take this thing reasonably seriously. So she started then to research, what's the latest on dinosaurs, and discovered the University of Montana at Bozeman and a prestigious Chinese university have both done studies on dinosaur bones that were unfossilized, contained pigments of blood or DNA that they're able to extract from the marrow, which means the dinosaurs are a lot closer to us than we ever thought they were. And so I'm working with her and a former student, Stephen Pavlik, to just start collecting these things now. And this is going to lead to a reexamination of all the tribal stories that deal with monsters and the European stories that deal with dragons. And there's already one report about to be published in Hungary of scientists there finding DNA in some of these bones. And so that's kind of where this current book is leading me. I don't know, these are two monstrous research topics, but ones that I would like to share with as much of the public as I can, because it's the amateurs that always make the great discoveries in the intellectual world. It's not the people in the universities. See, their minds have been closed and ruined for years. Oh, you want to give me the money? Okay. Yeah. Enough chit-chat here. Okay, well, those are two. You can see I get excited and I want to throw out some fish hooks, catch some of you, and get you on the computers doing this stuff. But thank you for coming.
We have a few questions for you.
All right.
We got a few moments for some...